We are live, we can go ahead.
Okay, thanks Ashok. Good evening everybody. So today we continue our series of online teaching programs for postgraduate students through the Orthopedic Research and Education Foundation, India. And today we will cover the clinical examination of the knee joint, and the speaker is going to be Dr. Ratnesh Singh, who's a consultant at Paras HMRI, Patna. So over to you, Ratnesh.
Thank you, sir, and good evening to all of you. Today I'm going to discuss the examination of knee joint, one of the most important joint, and many of the cases you will find in your examination. There are some prerequisites before you examine your patient. First of all, introduce yourself. Take a small history. Wash your hand properly. Confirm patient detail. And before examination, always explain what you are going to do with the patient and take verbal consent. Ideally, you should expose patient's leg. Patient should be wearing a short. Component of joint inspection is inspection, palpation, movements, special test, neurovascular examination, and short examination of above and below joint, that is hip and ankle joint. First, you inspect the gait. See for the symmetry of the gait, whether the gait is antalgic or not. I'm not going into the detail right now. It is already a big topic. Then you see for the attitude of the joint. You have to examine the patient both in standing, sitting, and supine position. Look from the front, side, and the back. First of all, check the skin condition. Is there any skin disease, any tuft of hair, any tattoo, or other things? Check for the redness around the knee. Look for the bruises, which may be the telltale sign of meniscus injury or ligament injury. Any previous surgery scars or any wound sinus or pus point on the skin. Then check the attitude. In arthritic condition, usually patients try to keep their limb in most comfortable position. That is in moderate flexion, which is optimal position at 25 to 30 degrees of flexion. Sometimes you may get a case like this, advanced case of tuberculosis, where the knee assumes attitude of fixed flexion deformity, external rotation, and posterior subluxation. You have to mention everything, every point in your notes. Then check for the knee swelling, whether it is diffuse swelling or it is confined to some part of the knee. If the swelling is diffuse involving both suprapatellar and infrapatellar area, it may be due to the effusion of knee joint. But localized swelling could be prepatellar bursitis, could be infrapatellar bursitis, could be meniscal cyst, which is usually found in joint line, could be due to the exostosis. Or see at the back of the knee, where you can find Baker cyst or aneurysm. In the left above picture, you can see it's a diffuse swelling involving all means suprapatellar and infrapatellar. This is most probably due to knee effusion. While other swellings are confined, like in left lower one, this is prepatellar bursitis. The middle one is due to Baker cyst or aneurysm. Right upper is the most probably due to the meniscal cyst. It is on the medial joint line. Or you can find the exostosis. Usually the exostosis is bilateral. Then look for the deformity. Whether there is genuvalgum, genuvalum, or decurvatum deformity. The swelling could be confined to one knee or both knee. It could be that due to the disease of the knee, or could be the part of the systemic disease like rheumatoid arthritis, in which you can find other joints, deformity of other joints, like in first picture you can see the deformity in the foot also. Then check for the position of patella. The patient should be made to sit on a couch with knee dangling at 90 degree of flexion and examine from the front and side. Normally, in this position, the patella should face straight forward. But in case of patella alta, here you can see the patella is seated above the normal position, like you can see in this picture, and it's facing up. While in case of patella vaha, the patella is seated below the normal level. You can also see the lateral position of patella in case of patella dislocation. That could be acute or could be due to habitual also. Then palpation. Palpate the knee properly. Look for the temperature change. Usually in case of infection, the temperature is usually raised around the knee joint. Look for the tenderness. First check for the joint line tenderness. It is done by flexing the knee and palpating the joint line with the thumb. Next, you check the tenderness of tibial tubercle, under surface of patella, patellar tendon, and quadriceps tendon. Check for the effusion. Look for the patellofemoral crepitus. There might be thickened synovial membrane, which may feel like spongy or boggy feel. And you can actually roll the edge with your finger and between your finger and your in the bone. Then check the power of quadriceps and hamstring muscles. Now to check for the effusion, you can do the patellar tap. It is useful for large effusion. Slide your hand down the patient's thigh, push down over the suprapatellar pouch. On reaching the upper core of patella, keep your hand there and maintain pressure. By this maneuver, you are pushing the fluid more downwards, and using the index and middle finger of the other hand, push the patella down gently. Then check whether it bounces. If yes, then the test is positive. You can find fullness of parapatellar tendon fossa inflection in cases of effusion, or you can do the bulge sign. For small effusions, you can try the bulge sign. Then check for the movements, both active and passive. Knee movement, flexion and extension. Rather, the extension, flexion from 0 to 135 degree is normal. Up to 5 degree of hyperextension is normal, but anything more than 10 degree is abnormal. And check for the rotation. It is usually 20 to 30 degree, but in flexion only in flexion. Rotation is not present in extension. Then check for the fixed flexion deformity by passively lifting the leg at the heel to see there is complete extension is present or not. Or see for the crepitus during movement. Now the measurement. Measure the Q angle. Q angle is the angle between a line from anterior superior iliac spine to the center of patella and the center of patella to tibial tuberosity. Compare with the other side. Normally in male it is 8 to 10 degree and in females it is 15 plus minus 5 degree. Means 10 degrees to 20 degrees in female. Now measure the muscle wasting. Mark the joint line and mark a point 15 to 18 centimeter above the joint line over the thigh, both side, and measure it with a tape and compare with the other side. Any difference of more than 2 degree is significant. Muscle wasting you can see in chronic illness. Now special test. Special test is done to check the integrity of ACL, PCL, meniscus, MCL, LCL, PLC, or patellar instability. And triad-rod test is done for the ACL to check the integrity of ACL in supine position with hip flex at 45 degree and knee flex at 90 degree, and the examiner stabilizing the foot by sitting on it. Grasp the leg firmly with thumb on the tibial tubercle. Check whether the hamstring are relaxed or not. It should be relaxed. Patient should be relaxed before any examination. Jerk the leg anteriorly. Significant displacement of 6 to 8 mm confirms the anterior stability. In tears, the endpoint is usually softer compared to the firm endpoint in intact ligament. But in case of posterior sag, the test will be falsely positive. Latchman test. This is more specific for ACL. You can do this in acute stage also, where you cannot flex the knee to 90 degree. In this position, the knee is kept at 15 to 20 degree only. One hand grasping the lower thigh and stabilizing the thigh. Other hand holds the upper part of leg. Upper part of leg is 6 feet shifted, is pushed anteriorly and posteriorly, means forward and backward. More than about 3 mm of anterior translation compared to uninvolved knee, or more than 10 mm total displacement is suggestive of ACL tear. End is usually soft endpoint. Pivot shift, this is also done to check the integrity of ACL. Patient lies in supine position and relaxed. Hip at 30 degree abduction, knee in internal rotation, and valgus stress is applied. This maneuver subluxates the knee. Now, gradual flexion is done from extension and see the reduction of lateral femoral condyle. It is specific for ACL tear. Sag sign. In 90 degree of knee flexion, support the heel. Tibias sags visibly posteriorly from the effect of gravity, like you can see in this picture. Compare with the other side. Sag sign is positive in PCL injury. Now, posterior draw test is done to check the integrity of PCL. It is done in supine position, knees flexed at 90 degree, hip at 45 degree, like in anterior draw test. And tibia is pushed posteriorly. Excessive posterior laxity and no hard endpoint is suggestive of PCL tear. Applace test, it is done to check for the meniscal tear. Patient lies prone, and knee is flexed at 90 degrees, and it is rotated by compressing. Longitudinal compression is applied into, and it is rotated internally and externally. It is done in grinding test or in distraction test. In grinding test, if pain is felt or click is felt, the test is positive and it is for meniscal tear. And in distraction test, if the pain is felt, this is more specific for ligament damage. McMurray test, it is done for meniscal tear. Firstly, knee is acutely flexed forcibly. Now palpate posterior medial margin of knee joint. And now gradually external rotation and knee extension is done. Any click or tear is suggestive of medial meniscus tear. Now the knee is again flexed, and now palpate posterolateral margin and do internal rotation plus knee extension. Any click or pain in this position is suggestive of lateral meniscus tear. Negative McMurray test does not rule out any gear. Squat test. The patient is made to squat with the foot in both internal and external rotation. Pain in the internal rotated foot suggests injury to lateral meniscus, while pain in externally rotated foot suggests injury to medial meniscus. Now, valgus and varus test is done to check the integrity of MCL and LCL. Valgus test is done to detect the tear in medial collateral ligament. Patient is made to lie in supine position and the knee extended fully. Use your one hand as fulcrum on the lateral aspect of knee joint and the hand at ankle joint. Apply abduction force on knee joint, which if positive result in joint space opening. If no abnormality is detected with knee extended, now the knee is kept at 20 to 30 degree, which relax the capsule and repeat the same maneuver. If joint open up at 30 degree, this is suggestive of MCL tear. And if joints open at full extension, this is suggestive of MCL plus other structures could be PCL or some deficiency of the capsule and others. Now, varus test is done to detect the integrity of lateral collateral ligament. The patient is in supine position. Keep one head on the medial aspect of the knee joint and other over the ankle. Start with knee in full extension, later with knee 20-30 degree flexion. Apply varus force to the knee joint. The test is positive in flexion indicates tear of LCL, whereas positive in full extension indicate combined injury to LCL, popliteus, and cruciate ligament. Patellofemoral stability can be checked by apprehension test. Pressing the patella laterally with the thumb while flexing the knee slowly may induce anxiety and surge resistance. In patellofemoral instability, patient, you will feel resistance by the patient. Now, dial test or tibial external rotation test is done to check the integrity of posterolateral corner. This test can be done with the patient in supine or prone position, but it is better with the patient in prone position. It is done with the knee both at 30 degrees and 90 degrees. Grasp the foot and the degree of external rotation of the foot is measured relative to the axis of the femur. A 10 degree difference between the two knee is considered positive. If the test is positive only at 30 degree of the knee flexion, it indicates isolated PCL injury. If the test is positive both at 30 degree and 90 degree, then it indicates injury to both PLC and PCL. Now complete your examination with neurovascular examination and short examination of hip and ankle. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So, any questions?
From DNBs?
Yeah. Sir, good evening, sir.
Huh?
Sir, do we need to do all the tests and document in every case of knee or there is some specific or should we, can we do some tests?
This much of the test should be done at least in all cases of knee.
I think what he has shown are the fairly basic tests, sir. If you are dealing with an injury, you need to concentrate on the various latchments, draws, dial, etc. If it's an osteoarthritic knee, you will concentrate more on where it's tender, range of motion, etc. So that's part of the diagnostic process. But these are fairly basic tests, which almost would be there in the full examination of the knee joint.
And sir, one more thing. In case of any joint in examination, do we need to examine all four joints? I mean, all both the hip and both the knee, or can we only examine the affected joint?
So I think so early on when you had long cases, you were expected to examine all the joints. Now, if they show it as a short case, and now you may even have OSCE, it's a totally different thing. So they'll just show you maybe one joint and you'll have to decide that. So it's slightly different at the moment, and we are in this state of flux where we are not sure what the next exam is going to be like. Okay. But if you go back to the old classical thing of having a long case and short case, in the long case, you would be expected to examine all the joints. In the short case, you wouldn't. You'd have to concentrate on the area that they tell you to examine.
Yes. Hello. Sumit. Yeah.
Sir, in dial test, from where we measure the difference in degree, that means from knee or from heel to second toe?
No, it's the angle between the long axis of thigh.
Okay, sir.
And the foot. Long axis of foot.
How do you, it's measuring it in the knee is very difficult. How do you measure rotation at the knee? I mean, you'll find it. So the foot is your guide of what's happening in the knee. You understand?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, Sachin.
Sorry, sir.
Okay, Avinash.
Hello.
Yes. Yeah. You have one question, right?
Yeah. Sir, I have one question regarding limb length discrepancy. We do Ellis test, and we see by doing angle flexing the knee at 90 degree, we see which is shorter. So many a times it is very confusing. Is there any conclusive idea that, so that we can make it that femur is short or a tibia is short?
So when you do the examination in the supine position and check the levels of the malleolus and the knee, etc.,
yes,
that tells you that there's limb is short.
Yes.
Okay, when you do the Ellis test, that means you put the patient prone and then flex his knee up to 90 degrees. If the height of the foot is the same level, that means the tibia is normal, okay?
Yes.
You understand? Because that is measuring from the knee to the foot.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so then you know if that is normal and the limb is short, you know it's in the femur.
In the femur.
Well, if that is short, you know that much shortening is in the tibia, okay? And similarly, you need to check the level of the knee to see where the two side femurs are in terms of the length, okay? So these eventually you have to measure for to make out the actual discrepancy. Yeah?
Yes.
But these are guidelines to tell you, okay, the shortening is more in the femur or the tibia or both.
Yes.
Okay. So one common mistake what usually done in the examination is about the piece in case of PCL tear, because usually on anterior drawers, because it is coming, because we are not sometimes we are not able to see the tibial tuberosity prominence if it is not done confidently. So what else we can do for that one, sir?
First to check on the sag and compare it with other side. If there is sag, you might feel it as positive anterior drawer test. But you have to,
yes, so first,
it means just use both of your thumb and keep it in infrapatellar fossa both side on same, means one knee. Usually in 90 degree, tibia is just anterior to femur. But when it sags, you can find the label. Another thing you can do, put your palm over tibial tuberosity and anterior surface of patella on both sides. This can also give you some idea of the sag. If the sag is present, then anterior dorsalis will be possibly positive.
See, normally in flexion, the tibia will be the articular surface or the margin of the articular surface will be actually anterior to the femur, okay? So you need to palpate that. If that is in normal behind, then you are starting from the position where the PCL is stretched, and when you pull forwards, it will come. And you say this is anterior draw. But what you have to see is to see from the correct position and then see which way it moves. Is it moving anteriorly or posteriorly? Okay, so you position it with your thumbs, feeling the tibial condyle and the femoral condyle, and then you push both ways and you see which way it's moving, okay? You need to get it to the correct position and then do the test.
And one more point I would like to say, that in case of, even in case of sag, if you find the translation, but you cannot find the soft point, it will be the hard point to end with. Hard point is always suggestive of intact ligament. Even if it's coming forward like 1 centimeter, but the end is hard, means just at some point you feel it's a hard, just a jerky stop, then anterior ACL is intact. The same way you go for posterior draw and then you find the soft point, then it will be suggestive of ACT.
Yeah, true, but it's not always so easy to make out hard and soft endpoints, okay? Yes, definitely some cases it's clear, but in many it's not absolutely clear that whether it's, so you can have something in between.
Sir, can we differentiate ACL tear and PCL tear on the basis of anterior draw and posterior draw?
Yeah, obviously.
Yes.
That's what it's meant for, no? But it, you could have both torn, okay? So yes. Then it'll be moving both ways from the norm, from the neutral point, okay?
So, another question is about the flexion test, sir. In coronal plane deformity, usually in most of the book, it is mentioned that you have to do flexion test to determine the deformities in femur or in tibia. So what is actually the, is it always right, sir, to do the flexion test, or the value is okay?
So I think it, if in valgus, so basically the general, this thing is that if the deformity is in the femur, when you flex the knee, it'll disappear. And that probably does happen, okay? But I think even for some proximal tibial deformities, it'll be less obvious when you flex the knee. Okay, so I think it's not an absolute test, but it does give you some idea. Okay, so you have to kind of watch it with caution. So if you have a severe valgus and then it, as soon as you bend the knee, it disappears completely, then you can be confident that it's on the femoral side, okay? But it's not an absolute. I won't say for minor deformities, you can be sure about it.
Okay? Sir, one common case what we are getting is habitual patellar instability in the examination. So for that one, sir, what is important to know? Because it is very little to be mentioned in the talk.
So, I mean, you can have different forms. One, it's dislocated, okay? Second is it dislocates, and third is apprehension. Okay, so when you push the patella laterally, the patient will guard. Another one where it, so habitual dislocation, it'll go out and in. Huh? And dislocated is dislocated all the time.
Every time it gets dislocated.
It's already, it remains dislocated, never really comes back into the correct place. Eh?
So,
and it's really dead. So,
and that's what it looks with every flexion. Every
habitual will go every time you flex, it goes. Yeah. Recurrent is the episodes, and then there, if you will feel the apprehension, mm-hmm. Okay. And then dislocated, it's out through the range of motion anyway. And you get that also.
And another thing, sir.
Especially some side of the congenital varieties, it's out on the side of the knee. Yeah?
So another one common case what we are getting is synovitis. Or is it the soft tissue which is more, or is it fluid, which is more, that to differentiate in between. So for synovitis case, what all test, like if it is small one, what Isda's book has mentioned that you can make the patient stand and do. So what all is important? So for a screening purpose in every case, because it is very less time for the to examine in a short case, about 10 minutes we are getting. So for a screening purpose, what test is important to do, sir?
You tell us.
Usually what we are doing is patellar tap, sir. But in standing, usually we are not doing, sir. That one, is it important to do in every case, sir? Or
if the effusion is present, you should do it at least. Obvious, if effusion is present, you should do that. Patellar tap.
Then about the synovial thickening, you have not mentioned in the talk.
You can feel it rolling under
few
your
points
thumb,
if you can.
Thumb and bone, between your thumb and bone. And further, if it is fluid, you can check the cross fluctuation test. That may be present in synovitis, but mainly it is present in case of fluid.
Yeah, so you can have synovitis and fluid, okay? So there you will have to feel both. So you will feel the thickened synovium rolled under your finger, but you'll also get the patellar tap and cross fluctuation. Okay. So you need to do both things. And also look at the back of the knee for things like Baker's cyst, etc.
In case of effusion of knee joint, do we need to do transillumination test, or it is necessary, or
mentioned somewhere definitely, but routinely we are not doing it.
You don't do it on a normal practice, but that's for, I mean, if that much effusion is there, you can easily tell on examination. So I don't know what this transillumination really tells us.
Yes, sir. In all the knee joint examination, we should mention about the case, sir, gait. Because it is lower limb.
Gait is important for any lower limb.
Usually the knee case is short case. So in short case, you have to tell only the positive findings. You will definitely see the gait, no doubt. And do examination according to the history. Suppose it's a case of effusion or synovitis, then do all the tests for synovitis. You can avoid some of the tests like PLC and everything. But in case of chronic instability, then you have to concentrate more on the stability test. And have to tell only the positive findings. You have to see everything, but you don't have to mention everything in your notes.
Yeah, you would have to. So, I mean, you would definitely see a gait in any lower limb case, okay? And if there's a limp, then you need to try and make out what kind of limp it is, whether it's antalgic or limb length discrepancy or what.
And one more thing, what I should mention here, if it is the case is given during the COVID, so the resident should know about the use of PPE kit and how to dispose that one, because for that one they used to provide PPE kit.
So, where have they done this,
sir? Because in few papers I was seeing about that one, sir. So what they are mentioning, that if it is they are giving a case, then they should provide the PPE kit also. So
I know, but at the moment I think they're not doing, at least the last exam, they did not do physical examination of PIM during the COVID. Maybe in the initial stage they had that, but yes, right, sir. Now they were doing OSCE. So
so they can change any time, sir. So we are not
depends
sure.
On it depends on how the COVID goes.
Yes, sir. So sir, they may ask principle of donning and doffing.
Yeah,
definitely.
that is also important. And what the most common case what we are getting during the examination is, one is multiligamentous instability, another one is Baker cyst, and what commonly we used to see in our OPD is osteoarthritis of knee joint. So for that one, what is important to know for the beginners during the examination, so that they can write the x-ray and all, because what we are seeing that they just wrote the x-ray of during the investigation also, x-ray AP view and lateral view. So what all is important to mention for osteoarthritis?
So I think, again, it's a question of, in your inspection, you're going to look for any deformity, okay, whether there's fixed flexion deformity or not. You need to look for any varus or valgus. Gait, you're going to look for things like a lateral thrust. Antalgic gait, whether there's a lateral thrust or not. A lot of varus knees will have a lateral thrust when they walk. Okay, and in the examination, you're going to do the standard series of tests, examination that you want to do. Again, tenderness, range of motion, crepitus, fluid, in whether there's an effusion or not, whether there's a Baker cyst or not. And again, all the positive things is what they expect you to see. Yeah, and also, I think even in these, you need to check basic. So again, here you need to be, so he talked about ligamentous instability, but another area that you need to be aware of is bony instability, okay? So a lot of these varus knees will have a false kind of positive varus instability, because the lateral collateral ligament gets stretched out and there's a gap on the medial side. So when you give them a varus stress, it's going to look as if it's opening out, but it's actually not really opening out, it's closing in on the medial side. Yeah. So again, you'll have to differentiate between a false and a true positive instability, or a bony instability and a ligamentous instability.
And one, just about the one confusion, sir, what we used to have during the examination, if it is a left knee to examine, which side the examiner should stand, sir? Left side or right side?
Right side, always.
Even for right, the left?
For right hander.
Okay.
For left knee examination, also we should stand on right side?
Yes, for right handers.
Okay. I think because it is.
Right to examine the knee, you will always find it become more comfortable from right side if you are using your right hand dominantly. If you are left hander, then you have to go on left side.
And we should examine the normal knee first. So,
Yeah, always.
And sir, when we are writing the X-ray prescription for osteoarthritis, so what all X-ray we should write, sir? Because is it when it is necessary to take full length lower limb X-ray, and when to write it is weight bearing X-ray, and when not to write a weight bearing X-ray, or both? Because it is also confusing.
Osteoarthritis, ideally, in every case, you should take weight-bearing
AP. Especially the AP X-rays are always weight-bearing. So there are some other views like a plateau view, okay, tunnel views, etc., which you would do in specific, or the tangential views where you do for specific cases. Again, if there's any deformity, ideally, you should do the long leg alignment film.
If it is a and about the skyline view, sir?
The skyline view is important for any patella instability, yeah? So, merchant's view. And then it depends. So, this is where there's a bit of confusion as to what position you should do the skyline view, okay? So, there, you can do it at 30, you can do it at 45, you can do it at 60. Okay? So depends on what you're looking at.
And sir, usually if it is a young patient with knee pain, we should write tunnel view, sir, if to rule out that osteochondritis dissecans or...
Yeah, so those are the X-rays which you do in special circumstances If you're looking for osteochondritis dissecans or loose bodies, etc.
Actually, your investigation depends upon your clinical finding and history.
Yeah.
What you are suspecting, you have to confirm your diagnosis by investigation.
And how to check for crepitus, sir? Because during the range of motion, what we are listening the crackling sound. But is there any other test which is we should mention in the exam?
Just the sound. You can feel the crepitus. Huh? It's not just the sound. When you keep your hand there and bend the knee, you will feel the sound.
Yeah. Yes.
Feel the grinding kind of thing.
And is there any
specific... more questions from the DNB students?
Sumit, I think most of the things we have covered, sir.
Okay. And in that case, we should call it a day.
Yes.
Okay, so I think that brings us to the end of this session. Thank you, Ratnesh, for making a short and succinct presentation on the knee examination and answering the questions and the doubts raised by the DNB students. So until next time, it's bye to everybody.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. And probably we will have an instrument on the next week, sir. The professor. About orthopedic instrument. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
Bye. Thank you.
Thanks.
So goodbye for now.
Thank you, sir.
Have a great evening.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.